Thank you, Dimitris. I think Dimitris made two mistakes here. First, he asked me to make the welcome remarks. The second, he asked me to say whatever I want to say in whatever topic I want to topic. So, you know, two mistakes already. But let me welcome you all to the second.
Don't abuse
it. I will. That's my job. welcome the second Kadir Has University International Relations Conference. This year, we thought it should be about the 25 years. I mean, one of the reasons why it should be is more selfish. The other one is more academic, of course. The selfish one is that our international relations department consists of academics and professors who are one way or another are dealing with this region. We have a high concentration of Eurasian experts in this university than anywhere exists anywhere else in Turkey. So that's a selfish reason we want to pay our respect to the region that we have been working. Secondly is, of course, a lot has happened in 25 years. It has passed like a blink of eye, for us at least. At one point in late 1990s, people were talking post-Cold War era. And that post-Cold War era never ended, it seemed. And after 25 years, we are still in that post-Cold War era. We couldn't manage to name a new era as international relations or political scientists or from any other perspective. So there should be something there that we should be either missing or we should be reanalyzing to see where we are going, where did we came, and what happened in the last 25 years, and where we can go from here. So this was the reason why we choose this this topic. Let me say a few words about the university. Some of you have been here before, but there are other friends who are coming for the first time. And at least one friend was asking about the building. So let me say a few words. This is an interesting place of Istanbul, an interesting building also. First of all, under the university, which most of you may not have seen or heard, there is a part of Byzantine cistern from 11th century. So if you force me to say when the university was established, I would say 11th century. So it's a long time ago we have been established and been here, right? We have our foundations there. It's a very nice one. It's not as big as the famous Yerebatan Sarnıcı, but it's quite a big one. It's not open to public, but a good one. On the second level above that is a part of an Ottoman hammam. When there is a water, there should be an hammam, of course. So, but on top of it, there is an Ottoman hammam from 16th century. A small part left, actually. But what's more important for us, of course, or more visible, is that we have this group of buildings here, which was established as a tobacco factory in late 19th century. And it was working until late 1970s. Then it kind of abandoned, and in 1990s there was a fire here. It collapsed the roof and everything. Then in 2001-2002 the university took it over and renovated. And they made a good job doing it. The effort got Europa Nostra Award for preservation of historic buildings. And of course we are keep adding new buildings and expanding here, but our main campus, let's say main buildings, are from that tobacco factory. And of course now it's by law, it's forbidden to have a smoke in this tobacco factory. Fortunately for some, unfortunately for the others. But if you have a time, we are a small university if you compare with other Turkish universities, but if you go around the campus, you would see small lights, I would call them, in every corner. The art appreciation, there are, although we are small, we have two galleries, one museum in the university. So there is a fair amount of knickknacks to see around. So if you have time, just go around and see. Let me say a few words about Eurasia, because Dimitri asked me to put some sort of a framework, so I'll do that 2 minutes, hopefully, right? Maybe a couple of things. First is the naming of the region. I think that's important. We have been talking about this region or regions. Now we said post-Soviet space. We are going to discuss it in the first panel, of course. But when I look at it, there are so many different names thrown around. There is a Central Asia. There was a Inner Asia. There was Middle Asia. To refer to the region where there are five countries now. There is this Caspian region or Caspian Basin. There is a Black Sea region. Transcaucasus or Caucasus or South Caucasus. You know, we have discussed that in the last 25 years as well. And then we had Near Abroad terminology. We had wider Black Sea region. That came from United States. Then we had a neighborhood, you know, somebody's neighborhood, European Union's neighborhood, of course, and different neighborhoods of the regional countries too. So I think the naming is a political affair in itself. I believe that. The names do not exist out of context. And as far as this region is concerned, the names mean something. So maybe we should be looking at it. What are we naming all this region after 25 years? Are we still calling it post-Soviet space? If we are still calling it post-Soviet space, it means that we have failed in last 25 years. I mean, we couldn't find even a name, it means, right? We are still referring to the Soviet Union that ended in 1991 in December. So that's the first issue. The second that I like to mention is that throughout this region, starting from Eastern Europe, ending in China, Chinese border. Throughout this region, the problems and dilemmas that we have talked about in last 25 years, or the problems and dilemmas that emerged in early 1990s, are still there. Right? None of them has been solved. I remember in late 1990s talking about uneven economic development throughout the region, problems of poverty, corruption, criminalization. We were talking about environmental degradation, the related ecologic problems. We were talking about ongoing nation building efforts, state building even, international competition for resources, etc. Or the political problems, lack of democratization, etc. But these are still the issues that, if you are looking into the region, they are the ones that we are still keep talking. And others added along the way on top of it. So this is an interesting region. In last 25 years, it accumulated problems, not solved them. And it has been somehow stabilized, part of it at least, but not. It doesn't mean that it solved its problem. So that's the second thing that I want to mention. The third is, in literature, again, the people who worked for this region would remember, late 1990s, early 2000s, there is a whole lot of literature calling this region as a transition countries. And some people started to writing books and transition countries. When I look at the region after 25 years, I have a feeling that this transition never ended. As a word, transition means that you start from one point, you end up in another point. But after 25 years, we are still on the road for this region. It's still transiting to somewhere. I don't know where. Politically, it's still in transition. It's changing, keep changing. Economically, it's still in transition. Geopolitics is constantly changing in this region. So there is this transition. I think the destination lost its importance now. And, what has left behind is the importance of traveling, moving from one point to another. So that's the, third point. And maybe the final point is that from the very beginning, Mehmet is sitting here, this region came into the attention of international politics because of its promise of energy resources. Whether they were real resources or imaginary resources, it doesn't matter. But that this what made this region more important for international politics in 1990s was its energy resources. Some of them actually actualized and we are using it. Some of them are still potential. Some of them are, we learned that it's not going to happen. But nevertheless, energy is still on top of the agenda, one of the issues in this when we talk about this region. But it also attracts international competition to the region. You know, without energy resources, I would doubt that so much international attention would be in this region, and I would doubt that so much other actors, international actors, would want it to have active in this region. So it is a blessing or a curse in both at the same time. So this is the last point that I like to mention, actually, that energy resources made this region both an opportunity and also vulnerability, and attracting international attention to this region. So I think that's a good, yeah, right? Okay, I'll stop here. Shut up. Let me thank about the reception. Okay, before thanking everybody, we are constantly doing things in this university, so many things. Tonight there is an exhibition is going to open. If any of you walk around, have seen maybe some construction going around the university. It's not a construction, actually. It's a building of an exhibition, art form, some sort. So we are having an opening at 7 o'clock. There is a reception with it, so you are all welcome to that reception before going into the dinner or whatever you want to go. I'll be there as well. Finally, let me thank all our partners. Dimitri already named them, so to save the time, I'm not naming all of them, but without them, their help, we wouldn't have been here. And also let me thank all the speakers, panelists and moderators for agreeing to come here, some new friends and some old friends. Nice to see you all here at Kadir Has University, and thanking for the listeners, let's put it that way. This meeting is about you, of course. So I hope we'll have enjoyable 1.5 day. Thank you all and welcome.
I'd like to welcome you all again. This panel is actually a big panel, and we actually have another panelist who's sitting, last minute addition, Mehmet Oguchu, who's also going to say a few things at this panel. He was supposed to be a speaker on the second one, but there was a change in his program. So I'll tell him to come up when it's his turn to speak. So here we'll be talking about the state of affairs in the post-Soviet space, a centrifugal development or centripetal drive, and we're sort of focusing on what's happening in what we call the post-Soviet space. While the other panels that will follow, one will deal with energy, one will deal with particular Russia's relations with the West, and then regional perspectives, which is the perspectives from some of the countries in the post-Soviet space and how they feel about developments there. You know, it's interesting. A colleague of mine just told me who won the Nobel Prize for Literature this year. Bob Dylan. Bob Dylan won the Nobel Prize for Literature. And I've been trying to think what to say, what's so memorable, other than, you know, the answer is blowing in the wind. But I was just reading, so according to The Guardian, and they were saying what the Academy thought, it's because for 54 years, he's contributed with his lyrics. with his thoughts. It's so interesting, right? And there was a delay in the vote, it seems, one of the rare things in terms of announcing him. So Bob Dylan, interesting, but I cannot think, and maybe some of you would think of linking it to our topic. One of the things we'd also like to do, since it's more of a policy conference, I mean, we've asked, each moderator has prepared a list of questions for their panelists, which would help guide the discussion. And one of the things I would like very much is, in tomorrow's concluding session, that we present, we will present the key points, the five or six key points from each session that we thought were relevant, and hopefully we get a cohesive sort of answer as to what's been happening in the space. The stream of news, and we just heard Mustafa Aydin talk about the stream of news generated from the post-Soviet states has not ceased over the last 25 years, whether the focus is on Russia, the Baltic states, Central Asian republics, or countries like Georgia and Ukraine, where the notion of territorial integrity and sovereignty have become dangerously blurred. And in fact, a lot of it has to do with the conduct of, you know, what is the conduct of Russian foreign policy and domestic policy today? We think about Ukraine, where now news are coming out of Kharkiv, Ukraine's second largest city, where it seems to be a repeat of what's been happening in eastern Ukraine, in the Donbas region. And so the news are not necessarily good. The Daily Mail has become a point of reference, if everyone has been following the story, right? Where, according to a story in the Daily Mail, which is it reputable or not, so the children, the relatives of Russian officials abroad have been asked to return, whatever that means. The direct accusations over the hacking scandal and the implications, therefore, for Russian relations with the US and the rest of the world. We've seen what's been happening in Central Asia, like a country like Uzbekistan and the post-Karimov era, and the implications of all that, and so on and so forth. So these are some of the themes of the conference. While here we will be focusing on a particular set of questions, which I just want to tell you what the questions were. One is there such a thing as a post-Soviet space that is a cohesive unit of reference? And I think Mustafa Aydin made an allusion to it that there might not be. Then what does Vladimir Putin want? Does he want to restore the Soviet Union? Or is it the case that nostalgia has been mistaken for ambition? Andrei Kurtunov has recently written a small piece in his blog, and he talks about this. Don't mistake nostalgia for ambition. Is that the case? What are the limits of Russian influence over the former Soviet Union? Is the post-Soviet space stable and vibrant in terms of being an exporter of security and an importer of security, where instability in some of the countries may impact on the post-Soviet space as a whole? What are some of the economic underpinnings of the post-Soviet space today? And of course, what do the next 25 years look like? We don't know, but maybe we should sort of think about that. And so our speakers, and I let me just introduce them, are people that could provide us, our expert that could provide us with some of the answers to these questions. So to my immediate right here is Fiona Hill, who is the Russia expert. Well, you are. The director of the Center on the United States and Europe at the Brookings Institution. Author of many books, and she keeps writing them and producing them, and with excellent analysis about, in terms of enhancing our understanding of Russia. Actually, last time I saw Kemal Kirishi, he gave me your book on Putin, which is a good reference book. Mustafa Aydin, I don't know what else he has to say. He already said what he had to say, but nevertheless, we'll ask him to contribute to this debate. But you know, when he was saying that there is know-how at this university, there is. A part of it is because Mustafa Aydin is one of the experts, not just in Turkey, but internationally, that knows this area very well. And he has rich academic and policy references that come with it. Ayça Ergun, to my immediate left, the Vice Chair of the Center for Black Sea and Central Asia at METU, at Middle East Technical University, an Associate Professor of Sociology at METU, another expert on the region, and the Center CORA has been around for a long, long time, and 25 years, so it's even older than this university. And so Aicha Ergun is another point of reference, at least in this country, about what is happening in the region. Sanford Henry, who is, well, I have him here as a partner, the Global Resources Partnership, but he has a wealth of experience on the Soviet space. He is going to provide us with an economic perspective. He has been going to Russia since 1966. And is involved, a believer in free trade, will give us his perspective on at least not just economic but also political, and what was going happening in post-Soviet space. And Alexander Vasiliev, who is a senior researcher at the Central Eurasia Research Center at the Institute of Oriental Studies of the Russian Academy of Sciences. Thank you for making the trip to join us. And our last speaker, who, as I said, is sitting with you, but he'll come up, is Mehmet Orgucu, who is a chairman of Global Resources Partnership. He's an energy expert, first and foremost, a former diplomat, and somebody who also has a wider geopolitical perspective, and let's see what he has to say. So basically what I've asked of the panelists is for 10 to 12 minutes to sort of give us their thoughts to start off on some of these questions, all of them or some of them, and so then we can get into a discussion about with you, your questions about where we are going. So maybe I'll just take this in order and start with you, Fiona.
Thank you very much, Demetrius, and thank you to Mustafa Adin and Kadir Has for inviting me to be here. I'm actually completely thrilled to be here because I've often visited the university only very briefly and fleetingly. The last time was just to talk to you in a corridor, and I've always very much wanted to come for a longer visit. So it's a great honor to be here for two full days at a conference. I also have come here directly from a series of meetings in the United Kingdom, and I see in the audience Ambassador Nalchivikas, who was there with me at a meeting at Ditchley Park on Brexit. And I'm going to pick up on this theme that Dimitrios has laid out for us today, to say that we're actually in a period of really rather remarkable questions about integration and disintegration. So I'm just going to prefigure what I want to say here. I don't want to take up too much time because otherwise there'll be disintegration on the panel and a lot of, and you won't get coffee afterwards. So I just want to throw out a few additional ideas to this because it's a very important thing to bear in mind. We're in a period of really incredible globalization. I'm sure there are many people here, students at Kadir Has, who have come from around the world. This is an international university, and Istanbul is one of the great crossroads of global trade, global economic relations. Alexander has actually written a book, which has just come out, on the linkages between the Ottoman and the Russian Empire and the European empires, dating back for several centuries. This is one of the ultimate crossroads. And the issue that we're here to talk about today is about what happened after the disintegration of a similar large geographic space. We're talking about the aftermath of disintegration of the Soviet Union. But what was the Soviet Union? The Soviet Union was a state, but it was also a system, and it was a system of political and economic interaction. It wasn't just an ideologically constructed edifice. And in terms of being a state, it was the heir to the Russian Empire, another of the great global empires. When it disintegrated and fell apart, it was in many respects the first victim of globalization. What do I mean by that? The actual system, the political system at the core of this, and the economic system, was having an incredibly hard time modernizing and adapting to larger forces, economic, political, and technological forces at the time. The Soviet Union wasn't brought down simply by the technological competition with the United States, but by the difficulties of the political and economic system to adjust to a very dramatic changes in the global economic environment, the oil crisis of the 1970s, and many different shifts. We also saw that it was, to some degree, the victim of populism. Now, that might seem somewhat ridiculous, thinking back to the Communist Party of the Soviet Union and what would have looked like, you know, very strict control over political debate. But in fact, there was a huge debate going on inside of the Soviet Union that was opened up under the Gorbachev period, as many here in the audience know only too well, about the nature of politics, the nature of the system. And there was a great deal of grassroots dissatisfaction across the whole of the Soviet Union with the system that was expressed in different ways. In many of the places that we're talking about today, in the regions that we look at, in places like Armenia or in the Baltic states, Georgia, that dissatisfaction started to take on a national form. It was expressed in kind of a sentiment of we're different from the other peoples of the Soviet Union. There was an ethnic or a national solution, perhaps, to this dissatisfaction with the state. We started to see independence movements and conflicts over identity that came up. But that was also going on at the level of Russians within the Soviet Union, within what was the Russian Federation. A big debate about who are we and where are we going. And it was the national elites, including Boris Yeltsin, who becomes the leader of the first independent Russia, who picked the Soviet Union apart. I mean, many of you remember, you know, back that three of them, heads of Russia, Ukraine and Belarus, got together in a hut, rather a dramatically nice hut, not exactly a small hut, in the Belarusian forest, and decided basically to launch a palace coup against Mikhail Gorbachev, the second coup that had taken part in a series of several months, and to dismantle the political system. None of them actually really thought that they were pulling apart the whole state, because there was an idea of creating a new form, a more equal form of association, of integration. There was talk of a new integrative system, the Commonwealth of Independent States, that would retain the same political and economic configurations, but would create a different form of integration. Well, we know that didn't work. So what happened? We ended up with the collapse of the old state system, the emergence of a whole host of new states, and Russia becomes the inheritor, the successor state to the Soviet Union. In English, it's got the unfortunate term of being called the rump state, which is not a very nice term in any language, but it means the remainder of what was then a much larger state. All of the other states that emerged in the Soviet Union gained something. They gained something new, they gained a new independence and a new perspective and a new future, and Russia loses. Russia loses the old perspective. It's the rump state, the successor state, but it doesn't have the whole system behind it. This is something very familiar, obviously, with audiences sitting in what is the rump state of the Ottoman Empire. And many countries today find themselves in a similar situation. So there's a rather a great grappling of this. So we have this attempt at new forms of integration after the disintegration, the Commonwealth of Independent States, which Russia wanted to leave. That does not succeed. And at the same time, all of the ties that bound the states together when they were all part of one system remain. People across now borders that become hardened. Long supply lines for industries that have to put themselves on a new economic footing. Infrastructure links, all roads, planes, trains, mostly went through Moscow to somewhere else. And the trauma of that disintegration leads down the line to conflict. Now, just to take me back to where I begin, because I mentioned Brexit here, at the same time that the Soviet Union is still going through its process of disintegration, trying to form new forms of integration, Europe, Western Europe in particular, is also seeing a time of gain, of winning an opportunity with the end of the Cold War to put itself on another footing. We see a vast integrative project emanating not just from the European Union, beginning from a founding member of six countries and then enlarging out from there, but also from NATO. So Russia and the Soviet Union lose one axis. But at the same time, the systems in the West, the institutions of NATO and the European Union, don't change, but then start to go through a massive period of transformation. And you get a clash between one integrative process and a disintegrative process that doesn't find a new integrative angle. Europe and NATO, the European Union, have this vast period of expansion in 2004 that takes the EU and NATO both into the post-Soviet space. And I think that really sets the scene for everything that we're probably going to be talking about on the panel today. A clash of what it appears to be two different systems of integration, because in the same period, Russia starts having seen the failure of the Commonwealth of Independent States under Vladimir Putin to try to think of other forms of integration. Now, this integrative impulse within Russia has been a long-standing one. Many of you who are here in the audience as historians will remember at certain points under the Russian Tsars, there were ideas of pan-Slavism that were put forward as an integrating process. It didn't always work with the Turkic peoples of the empire, clearly. But there was also an idea at a different point before the Russian Revolution of creating a United States of Eastern Europe. So these integrative impulses have always been there in different ways. And when we start to think about what's on the minds of people in Moscow, these ideas of being at the head of a much larger integrating space really remains, and how what form that takes, political, economic, or military, is obviously the big big point of contention. So we end up by 2004, I would argue, in a very contested space in what was supposed to be a place for a new opportunity, new integration, place of gain and transformation, transition, as Demetrius, you said at the very beginning, that starts to become a big question mark. We had the clashes in 2008 over the future of Georgia and the direction which Georgia would take in this space. And then the real clash that's led to a great rift between Russia and the West, however we define it now, in 2013 and 2014 over Ukraine. And you mentioned developments lately in Kharkiv. But now, and I don't, as I said, don't want to take up much time, when we seemingly saw Europe in the ascendancy in the European Union, we've had a whole new development in June of this year in 2016 with the referendum in the United Kingdom to leave the European Union. So the integrative process that we thought we took for granted in Europe and the European Union now actually look to be at an end. And I think the next 25 years is going to be shaped. This is why we're going to have a very difficult time in finding a name for this era, Mustafa. It's going to be shaped by the big dilemma of the end, perhaps, of integration in Europe and new forms of association. Because the big periods of regional integration no longer look like that they are the solutions to the problems of globalization. And everyone is, as Demetrius was saying, looking to sovereignty, to national solutions. It's the hallmark of pretty much every government that we see right now. Britain wants to go to a golden age of Britain, but I'm not sure if it ever existed. There are questions about mobility across borders between countries that we haven't tackled for a long time. There's a backlash against mobility. So in the times when we were sitting here in the Ottoman Empire where people actually took mobility for granted, we're now having questions about what the future of mobility will be across borders in Europe as well. Questions about citizenship and what does it mean to be a citizen of a particular country. And as I said, if we look forward to the next 25 years, this whole question about integration on a global and regional scale seems to be imperiled by a return to national debates. And the United Kingdom could very easily find itself and England as the rump state of another old empire. There's already been the disintegration of the British Empire, but Brexit raises the question of the further disintegration of that state with Scotland, Northern Ireland, the future of Ireland, and potentially the reunification of the island of Ireland. And the questions then of European Union itself, less likely to become a United States of Western Europe or of broader Europe, are much more likely to be a question of a variable, strange structural geometry in which there's a big question of whether there's more integration or more disintegration. So I'm just throwing this out into a different direction here because I think we've actually reached a point of an end of one 25-year period and the beginning of another, which looks even messier than it might have looked in the 1990s.
Thank you very much. I think we do have our first key point of the conference, and this thing about integration, disintegration, I think, sums it up very well. Let me go on with you, Mustafa. I don't know if you have anything else to add. Be short.
Yeah, that means that don't speak much. Yeah? Okay, having made my key points already, so let me try to build up on them with a few words, trying to answer Dimitris's first four questions, not all of them. I mean, I already said there is a problem of post-Soviet space using the terminology. And you know, when you put it as a question, whether it's a cohesive unit enough of reference, my answer would be yes and no. Yes, it would be difficult for non-Soviets or non-post-Soviet people to understand, but if you travel throughout this region, you get a feeling that there is something unique and there is something to bonding these people in this vast region. Sometimes you can call it friendship, sometimes not, but there is a kind of, it's very difficult, but you get feeling of it. There is certainly for the older generation or in their midlife generation, there is certainly Russian as a lingua franca, there is a connection there. There is a cultural connection for sure. And there is a shared history. These all matters. If you go an international conference, you would see, suppose enemies going together, having a drink together, speaking Russian and eating similar food. So there is this affinity and etc. But I think that's about it. You know, that's why I go no, because when I look at it politically, strategically, economically, from different perspectives, this region is disintegrating, using Fiona's terminology. It's not integrating, it's disintegrating. It's moving separate ways. This is more sure, more clear, more there for some certain countries and less for the others. But nevertheless, the trend is unmistakable. You know, if you go to Tbilisi, Baku, you would definitely feel that you are not in the post-Soviet space. It's something different now. There are other cities when you go, you feel like, okay, it's part of the post-Soviet space. But the trend is unmistakable, it's changing. But it's taking, for many people's states, I would argue, that it's taking too long a time. You know, many people have argued that within a decade, this post-Soviet space thing would disappear and many countries in this region would integrate with other regions. There were so many plans and programs of such, political or otherwise. This didn't happen. So I think we, not only we as academics, but the politicians as well and you know, other experts of the region have made a mistake of thinking that this disintegration would have been easier. It didn't happen. But if you look at whether this is an analytical, from analytical perspective, whether post-Soviet space is a unit of analysis, I would definitely say not anymore, not academically. If we like to substitute, I think there are different regions and we have to start thinking separate part of this region, sub-regions. Central Asia is totally going a different way than, say, Western post-Soviet countries. I call, if you force me to call this region, I call it Eurasia, which is an old terminology again, but we can discuss it and put it a new twist on it. So to the second question, which is more important, I think not what happened in the last 25 years, but what's gonna happen next 25 years, whether Vladimir Putin is actually trying to re-establish Soviet Union, or he has something other ambition in mind. I'm quite certain that he's such a personality who wouldn't establish what was happened before him. Right? He is definitely after something new. You know, some people might call it Putinland, but it's not Soviet Union a la Putin. It's different. What he is trying to do is, of course, to regain the power and influence that the Soviet state had one time in this geography, but even more. Because Soviet state was actually a not functioning state. So Putin would have won some functioning state that has the Soviet power over people and over the region. So I think what he is, in IR academic terminology, what he is after now is to be a for his country, of course, to be a pole position in a multipolar world. He realizes, and I think Russia now realizes, that a bipolar world is gone. It's not going to come back. Even if it comes back, Russia might not be one of the poles. But it is almost certain that if there is a multipolar world, Russia would be one of the more powerful poles. So that's what I think, at least for now, that's what Russia and Putin are trying to aim. And to be able to do that, Russia and Putin, I use interchangeably here, has to contain and push back the Western influence on its borders. Fiona already mentioned this movement. Since the end of the Cold War, if you are sitting in Moscow, what you are seeing is the coming, you know, West is coming towards you from everywhere. It's in the Ukraine, it's in the Caucasus, it tries from the south, from the north, everywhere. So if you are aiming to achieve a pole position in a multipolar world, you have to first push back the West. Of course, I think he also rightly calculated that it's not easy to push back NATO and European Union itself. But it might be easier to prevent some of the neighbors, former Soviet countries, to joining the Western area and integrating it. So the result is 2008, August, Georgia, and 2014, Ukraine. So with these two operations, he successfully prevented not only these two countries, but the regions in these countries are in to move towards West and integration with the West. So I think he managed and he succeeded the first part of his strategy. Once you manage that, if this is a correct reading of what Russia and Putin is doing, then your next strategy would be to expanding that that area of influence. And for that, we all know that you either need intercontinental ballistic missiles, which Russia has, but that doesn't give you a control of territory. It gives you a control of air somehow, and it also helps you to secure yourself from other superpowers and the countries who have those kind of missiles and abilities. But it doesn't give you power to control and influence certain territories. Intercontinental ballistic missiles doesn't do that. You have to be there to have an influence. Then that brings us to back us to age-old the Russian-Soviet question. You know, the Russian Empire and the Soviet Union faced the same dilemma, and now the Russia. You have to expand territory, and you have to have powerful navy to do that. And hence, I think annexation of Crimea. You know, it's annexation of Crimea is different than creating another frozen conflict in Ukraine. That was something else that prevented Ukraine to moving to West. But annexation of Crimea gave Russia a huge springboard in the Black Sea. Now it controls the more than 60% of Black Sea waters. And now it can project power from Black Sea to around. And that around actually includes, traditionally actually includes South Caucasus and Eastern Europe. If you look at the history, not only the Russians, but whoever controlled the Black Sea, they projected power to Eastern Europe and South Caucasus easily. So that would be the next game plan. And also successfully 2015, Russia revamped its maritime strategy and deciding to put billions of dollars and rubles into different navies of Russia. But the big share, lion's share of that money is earmarked to go to the Black Sea Navy. Is it just to secure the Black Sea? No. As Russian head of the army came to Turkey, he 2-3 weeks ago, he openly said that now the Black Sea Navy of Russia is the strongest navy in the Black Sea. We are secured in Black Sea. That's what he said. So assuming that he's correct, and I know he's correct, then why are you putting more money into the Black Sea Navy? Then you can understand the role, that there should be another role for the Black Sea Navy. Hence the Syria. The Syrian operation of Russia is supported and logistically kept alive by the Black Sea Navy. And this is when you say Syria, you have to remember that for the first time in history, the Russian history, Russia is establishing a permanent base in Syria, in the Middle East. Not, you know, Tartus is not a permanent base, for example. They are establishing a permanent base in Syria. What that means is that some sort of a power projection somewhere in the Middle East and Eastern Mediterranean. So I would assume that's what he is after, the second part of his thing. What are the limitations? The next question is, I think there are several limitations to this ambition and the policy. Economically, there is a huge limitation. I mean, you know, Russia is limited with its economic resources. Samford will be much more able to talk about it. But you know, it depends on energy resources, oil prices, and putting so much money, or at least thinking to put so much money into the Navy. We will see whether that will be possible or not in the next 25 years. And let us not forget what caused the collapse of Soviet Union, among others, was the armaments race with United States, putting too much money onto the armaments. So that, let's keep that in mind. So that's economic. Ideologically, there is a huge limitation. Soviet Union had an ideology. It was not just a state. It was a state with an ideology. And that there were people not only across the Soviet countries, but you know, even outside Soviet Union, who adhered to that ideology. There is no comparable ideology in Russia today. So if you are going to the soft power kind of thing, you need an ideology, something that people believe in, trust in, and want to associate with. There is nothing in Russia that post-Soviet countries wants to be associated with. Not many, at least, let's say. Ideologically, there is none. Politically, of course, in the post-Soviet territory, I would say there is no voluntary aspiration from any countries to be integrating or reintegrating with Russia. To be sure, and we have to accept the reality, there are countries who are more and less integrated with Russia and dealing with Russia, but they, more or less, they are also coerced to do so. Left alone for their willing, I would say 90% of them would not like to be go forward with Russia. And security-wise, of course, there is a limitation. I mean, you know, putting money into the Black Sea ship and the other navies of Russia would not be definitely enough if you if we start to have a race on armaments. That's for sure. And let us remember, Soviet Union, maybe from the first few years that after the excitement passed, Soviet Union existed based on police terror and fear. It was a police state or security state of sort. Current Russia may be aspiring to be one. It's not yet, and I don't think it would be able to be one of them. So you know, there are all these limitations that the post-Soviet space could really come under the Russian influence totally. The final question, say a few words, is about whether this region has become a stable, you know, security provider, exporter or not, or importer of security. It's definitely not. But you know, if we try to look to all this region altogether, then we fail to see the reality. For example, Central Asia, of course, it's not providing security to anywhere. It's not exporter of security, but it's not anymore consumer of security either. It doesn't create threats to neighboring countries. If you put Afghanistan into part of Central Asia, then you might start talking about threats and etc. But if you leave Afghanistan out, but talk about post-Soviet Central Asia or Eurasia, it's more or less stable, even though the leaderships are changing now, and many people are fearing that there will be succession problems. Even in Uzbekistan, it didn't happen.
Kyrgyzstan had already changed twice, I think, if I remember correctly, after Turkmenistan. Now the Kazakhs are coming online, so we'll see. But it's almost managed the succession problem too. So Central Asia has more or less stabilized. Caucasus, it's frozen. You know, it's to use the terminology. It's not stabilized. It's not definitely stable. It's not definitely frozen either. It's bubbling. It's so small a space, there are so many bubbling things there, and it can ignite at any time. We saw it just recently between Azerbaijan and Armenia again. So it can blow up. And the rest of the Soviet, post-Soviet region has become more volatile, of course, with the Russian action in there, with Ukraine and the following. So what I see for the future is, I put the same wording here, actually, Fiona used, for the next 25 years, I see a kind of conflictual, contested, and divided region for the post-Soviet state, unless it is repressively consolidated. I don't see a consolidation of voluntary reintegration in this region, either with Russia or with the West. It has to be forcefully consolidated, otherwise it will remain as divided and contested region. Maybe that's for the better anyway. Thank you.
Thank you. So you're ending with giving people ideas to repressively consolidate. This is what I heard. Let me move on to Ayça Ergun with her take.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be with the old friends and meet with the new ones. By the time we started study former Soviet Union, it was a promising land. For the students of international relations and political science, we thought that actually, well, I'm talking about like 20 years ago, we thought like, we're going to study transition. We will belong to the discipline of transitology for about maybe 10 years. Then the territories that we are working on or we are studying will promise some other areas of research. So I would like to focus on more whether the post-Soviet space is a coherent unit of analysis or whether it's possible to analyze the former Soviet Union or the post-Soviet states space as a unit of analysis. I would like to draw attention on more domestic politics and try to conceptualize whether it's possible to treat the region as a whole. So we have enough evidence to actually underline the unity, that is the Sovietization and Russification, Russia constituting the source of modernization for the countries of the former Soviet Union, more or less created a sense of citizenship, that is the Soviet identity, but also contributed to the formation of nation-state identities and national identities. Than the democratic consolidation. This is what the literature taught us based on the previous experiences. By the time we realize that actually transitology does not help and it is not really a never-ending transition, then we started to qualify the regimes, saying that, you know, hybrid regimes, petro-authoritarianism, authoritarianism, semi-authoritarianism, etc. But still acknowledging there are patterns of change. Another approach to the study of the post-Soviet state was like more focusing on society, making more like society-centered approaches or analysis rather than state-centered approaches. So we thought at the beginning that actually if the ruling elite is reluctant to democratize their own countries, well, after some time there will be societal actors who will ask for a top bottom-up kind of a move for democratization. It did not happen either because of the persistence of the authoritarian practices in the region. However, again, as mentioned, insecure sense of nation building. That the state-building identities can be under question too. We still see variety of clientelism, corruption, and bribery in the region, and we don't really talk anymore the processes of democratization or democratic consolidation. It was, I think, late 1990s, Rogers Brubaker called the regions, region as, you know, states in the making and nations in the making. I think this terminology is still valid. Moreover, challenges of state building and nation building persist, particularly in the Southern Caucasus. Regional cooperation is not institutionalized. Varieties exist, obviously, in the region. But I would then argue that if we will look at the patterns of domestic politics, we can still treat the region as a unit of analysis, with particular reference to the domestic politics or varieties of regime types. So this is my answer for the first question. The second question was whether Putin wants to restore the former Soviet Union. This question reminded me kind of an instance that I experienced like 15 years ago. I was in a conference in Ukraine, and there were Russians, Ukrainians, and Crimeans actually talking about possibilities of integration, cooperation, and coexistence. I was a student by that time, and I was like, well, I mean, these Russians, they don't really consider themselves as, you know, equals or equal partners, but rather trying to dominate the whole discussion. And then a British friend of mine, she said that, well, you shouldn't be surprised, consider that the UK still couldn't really overcome the trauma of not being the imperial power, so that we should give some time for the Russians to actually overcome this trauma. So I think Putin or any other Russian leader would not necessarily like to restore, but most probably would like to guarantee the persistence and the endurance of Russian influence in the region, maybe in some institutional forms or maybe some informal networks. However, I think that the independence, the notion of independence and the notion of sovereignty are highly valued by all regional countries. So it's not anymore whether the Russians or anybody else will intervene and advise us to do so. Independence and sovereignty, the notions associated with independence and the notions associated with sovereignty are highly valued. So if we look at the early discussions of nation building and state building in the early years of the post-Soviet period, it was like, let's build a nation, let's build a state. So these are the discourses, these are the vocabularies, these are the sources that we should be looking at. This is how it was formulated. But I mean, after 25 years, although there are significant challenges, I can say that these countries, all regional countries, they're really, really enjoying the value of independence and sovereignty. And I don't think that this is something to be questioned, sacrificed, or underestimated, still acknowledging the Russian dominance in the region. So we are now talking about independent countries. Okay, maybe they are not equal partners in terms of partnership or regional integration. However, I do not think it's not going to be that easy for Putin to restore the Russian influence in the region. Well, it is still there, but I mean, this is not going to be something to challenge the notion of sovereignty and independence. The third question, what are the limits of the Russian influence? I kind of am formulated this question, like, instead of asking the question this way, we can maybe ask who or which insider or outsider can limit the Russian influence. In terms of domestic actors, I think that the first and foremost, the ruling elite is the one, the presidents are the ones who can limit the Russian influence. And maybe kind of approve some sense of influence. And I think youth is an important factor in limiting the Russian influence, because, I mean, there is obviously a generational change. Some of the old leaders, they are in power, or the old regime's signifiers have been reproduced, embedded, re-articulated, but on the other hand, there is a generational change. There is a generation in the region who only knows about the former Soviet Union from the stories that they heard from their parents. So they have a concept, but they don't really experience the notion of Sovietness. They are high professionals. They know what's going on in the world. They know what democracy means or democratization means. And they are familiar, they have familiarity and acquaintances with the outside, their own territories. So English is a very important medium of interaction and integrating with the other part of the world. And their levels of education, or the kind of quality of education that they get, is highly important. So that's why I think the more ruling elite and the new generation can be the limit, at least, of the Russian influence, at least in terms of its kind of articulation to the discourses and practices at the state and nation level. What can be the other outsider or outside actor influence to limit the Russian influence? It's the, I would rather call it institutionalization of internationalization. So we need to have international cooperation networks, organizations maybe, to institutionalize the patterns of integration in the region, so that we can limit, or the world can limit, the Russian influence. Well, EU was a candidate kind of 10 years ago. However, because of the highly bureaucratic and kind of slow structure of the EU in the region in terms of its activities, it's not kind of a, well, we can say that it's an increasing Euroscepticism towards the actor, towards the EU in the region, particularly in the South Caucasus. So that, I mean, if we could, we are able to institutionalize internationalization, maybe we can prevent isolation and find some other sources of integration. Do I have time? No? 2 minutes. Okay. I'm going to skip the security question. Well, the last question was, what do the next 25 years of the post-Soviet space look like? Well, I don't know. Because, I mean, we thought that it was a very promising land for us. We thought that transition will be over. Well, it still persists. We thought that democratization, and by today, actually, we thought that we will be talking about patterns of democratic consolidation rather than varieties of authoritarianism, or an effort of, you know, defining, labeling types of authoritarianism by acknowledging the presence of the change. Well, okay, continuity and change still competes, but competing coexistence of continuity and change is not that powerful anymore, because we can see that Soviet, early post-Soviet practices at the state-building level are being reproduced, embedded and articulated by the new societal actors too, particularly the young generation. So we keep on working on the region because we love it. It's our first baby. We love our case studies. We love our regions. But I don't really think that we will be able to discuss something else, let's say, in the next 10 years. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ayça. You know, when you talked about the generational change, I was thinking, I mean, it's John Lewis Gaddis, right? He wrote The Cold War, and he prefaces it by saying that I started realizing, I've been teaching
the Cold War for such a long time, and I'm teaching now to a new generation of students that it's history for them. And I think in a way you brought in that element that we need to consider. Before I give the floor to Sanford, I want to give it to Mehmet, who is very nervous about something. He has to leave, so Mehmet, please, come to the podium.
Thank you, my apologies,
and also the audience. The post-Soviet space, the history of that, for me, is not a history. Most of it, we lived through, our generation lived through it. So we have personal experiences, anecdotes, and our professional life also somehow connected to that. I was a young diplomat in Beijing when Soviet Union collapsed. So I observed it from Beijing. Before that Tiananmen incidents, when Gorbachev came, and so this was a very eye-opening experience for us. Then I also contributed the post-Soviet reconstruction and reform in Russia as a OECD executive. We developed a program, Economies in Transition, on privatization, taxation, corporate governance, improving investment climate. So much work we have done on Russia as well as other countries in transition. We also opened a competition within OECD, how to name these countries which emerged from Soviet Union. We didn't know how to address them because, yes, former Soviet republics for a while, it went through, but it didn't satisfy, especially the countries which escaped from the yoke of Russia or Soviet Union. So then we found the new independent states, NIS, for a while. It worked well, but later on, they were no longer near. And so it went like this. Then we said CIS as well, for those who were under the Commonwealth of Independent States, but not all of them were under it. So now, thanks God, we are able to name them by their names, although still for five Central Asian republics, many in the West are talking about Istans. So they confuse Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan with one another. And I also met Putin when he was the deputy mayor of St. Petersburg in charge of international cooperation. And in my capacity as an OECD executive there, helping St. Petersburg government. And also when the, of course, the demise or the defeat of the coup d'etat that took place, which symbolized the beginning of a new era in Russia, which we thought will be liberal and in many ways democratic as well. Then Yeltsin demised and came Putin, a very successful, bright KGB operative. And a friend of mine was telling me that I think the best investment KGB had in its history was Putin, a mastermind of chess game. And he did also, by the way, his PhD in St. Peter's University on how to use natural gas as a political weapon. So when you sit down and negotiate with Putin, so you cannot play backgammon. You need to play also chess game as he does. Although part of his PhD thesis was not written by him, it was also proven. And
he read it,
at least. He defended perhaps also. And he also called the demise of the Soviet Union as the greatest catastrophe, geopolitical catastrophe of the 20th century. And therefore, you can read his mindset in which ways he thinks that Russia should be moving. Then came, of course, so many initiatives like customs union, initially between Kazakhstan, Russia, Belarus. Now they want to extend it to other republics. And then Eurasian Economic Union, now merging into Eurasia Union, which he thinks might be perhaps challenging European Union. Then collective security organization, a mirror image of NATO, but none of them has really worked seriously. These are good schemes in his mind, and bringing together heads of states through coercive diplomacy that he uses so successfully. Then we also had Shanghai Cooperation Organization, which actually Chinese pioneered. It was aimed at basically providing security and as a shield against the Central Asian instabilities coming to Xinjiang Uyghur Autonomous Region especially. And also now he's facing a serious challenge in the region, in his near abroad, China. We never, none of us mentioned so far. And Russia faces the China challenge. I wouldn't say risk or threat, but I would call it challenge for the time being. There is a marriage of convenience between Beijing and Moscow in many ways. They have common interests for the time being, but the Chinese are not as anti-Western as Russians have become. So they prefer more collaboration and partnership. We can see a good example of this through the revival of Silk Road, ancient Silk Road, by way of One Belt, One Road initiative, which is investing now in infrastructure along the route, 65 countries. Yesterday, one of our Chinese colleagues was telling that the budget for that is about $90 to $100 billion per year. And nobody in the world today has this power, financial power, technical power, to put behind infrastructure projects in the world. So China is doing this. And China will never treat Russia as an equal partner, as it used to be in the, in fact, the Chinese were not treated as an equal partner by Soviets. Remember Stalin, Khrushchev. And, but now Russia is treated as a younger brother that can provide perhaps some military fighters, jets, and hardware, and also raw material. And do you know any Russian marks, any trademarks or brands which are good in manufacturing or in service industry? They are very good in military technology, we know that. But Russia depends heavily on the exports of raw materials and commodities and minerals. So if you have a trouble in the international markets as we have now, then this is a very alarming signal for Russia. And Russia also is a master of using coercive diplomacy in many areas, but particularly in energy as well. And within the former Soviet space, still I don't have a name for that, perhaps we should open a competition for naming it and give this as a gift to the international community. Georgia, Armenia, they wanted to buy all the infrastructure, especially pipelines and the power network. And before we discuss Turkish Stream and other projects relating to Turkey, and Putin, before going to St. Petersburg to meet Erdogan, to hack him again, after having accused him stabbing in the back. And he was in Baku to sign another agreement with Azerbaijan, Georgia, Armenia, and Iran to create another energy corridor that way. So north to south. And also they made it clear and assured that Turkmen gas will not be able to find its way across the Caspian. I challenge this. I think Turkmen gas can find its way to Baku first and through Georgia, Turkey to the west. How? Only by sending, because the Turkmens keep saying that, come and get it on the border, in the Caspian border. So you can do this only if you send it as an attachment, email attachment, and unzip it on the Azeri side. So neither Moscow nor Tehran will never consent Turkmen gas to come that way. Therefore, I always used to say that east of Baku, forget about the west. It's Russia and China that calls the game and fires all the shots. And this is changing somehow because of what happened recently. Azerbaijan also increasingly coming under the strong influence and coercive diplomacy of Russia. And if the West doesn't behave and pull itself together And Azerbaijan might also be under the risk because Russia has all the levers because of Armenian conflict, Georgia, because the Southern Gas Corridor, you know, a pipeline is as secure as its weakest point. And so we'll come to that. But on energy, I want to say a couple of words. For Russia, of course, energy is not a simple commodity trading or political relations matter. It's a national security matter, like it is for Turkey. Because I would like to remind you that 98% of Turkish natural gas comes from abroad, so we have to import. 93% of our oil, again, imported, so we depend heavily on that. Coal, technology, finance, you name it. Therefore, this is also for Turkey national security matter, but more so for Russia, as I said, they don't have any serious manufacturing or service industry or agriculture for that matter. So they need it desperately. Oil is number one priority for them because it provides almost 37-38% of the national budget for Russia. Gas is 7% in the national budget. Therefore, Tatiana was telling us yesterday in our Bosphorus Energy Club meeting that Russia uses natural gas as a political weapon as much as it can. So it can afford to do so. And but Russia, under the sanctions now, are really suffering much. It's not cracking under it, but suffering we know. And its adventures in Syria, which is somehow a reflection of the Soviet, perhaps, attitude, global role, for the first time it's playing outside the former Soviet Union. As also Mustafa said, is part of the Russian strategy to establish a stronghold in the Middle East and Eastern Mediterranean, somehow also related to energy, what's happening in East Med, Zohr field with Egypt, Leviathan, Tamar of Israel, and also around Cyprus. So you shouldn't ever consider this beyond that. Perhaps a few words about the Turkish-Russian relations, because I know that our time is limited, and I also inserted myself into that. So give me another 2 hours to talk about the Russian-Turkish relations, if I may. Huh? So the relationship in the post-Cold War era with Russia, I think if you look at it, the Blue Stream project was a hallmark of the relationship. 1986, 87 construction, and it also killed, you may remember, Trans-Caspian pipeline, which we wanted to build with Turkmenistan. It was going ahead, but by building Blue Stream project, it was an economic project, commercially viable. It's still not, because it's operating under its capacity, and the Russians gained a stronghold in Turkish energy market and then leverage. Through this also we had other relationship, construction business. So we have a package deal now with Russia in which the backbone is energy, but you have defense and security, you have tourism, construction, and agriculture products, and you name it. And the balance, it was a balanced relationship, but now balance is shifting in favor of Russia more and more if we come to today's world. Because in the wake of the 15 July failed attempt of coup, and Turkey is largely isolated internationally, and it has a huge disappointment and disillusionment with the West, Europe and US included. Therefore, it turned again towards Russia. Then came St. Petersburg handshake. And then Putin coming yesterday to Istanbul to sign the Turkish Stream Agreement. And also he signed an agreement regarding the strategic investment status for Akkuyu power plant. Then all of a sudden we saw another item, including Russia as a possible site for or partner for anti-missile, anti-defense missile deal, which initially Turkey was going to give to China, then under pressure from NATO and US, shifted to a US firm. Now Russia is also in the picture. So this, I don't know how important this missile deal, but we keep using it as part of our energy, security, political diplomacy, about $4 billion worth deal. But Turkish stream has serious implications for our energy security, because we realize that in November 2014, it was a wake-up call. Russia cut off very vital economic ties. They didn't threaten about the energy supply, but we were so much worried. What would happen if Russia disrupt the flow of gas to Turkey? 55% of Turkey's gas comes from Russia. As a result, we are looking for other options to diversify. Don't put all the eggs in the same basket, in the words of President Erdogan. And so Iran wanted to double its gas exports to Turkey. In the Kurdish region of Iraq, where a company I work with also operates, we are about to produce 10 BCM of gas that can be transported to Turkey 200 kilometers away, almost ready, just you need to put some money to make it happen. And then also we signed long-term deals with Qatar on LNG. We also built FSRU, floating LNG. And then East Med Gas from Israel, from Egypt, Cyprus perhaps. I don't think they are going to happen anytime soon, because today we are living in an era of abundance of gas coming from every direction and very cheap. Why should we invest in expensive gas coming from Israel and elsewhere? But still, it will be part of the energy diplomacy. And I think one additional word about China I forgot to mention. Russia thought that if Europe is creating problems for Russian supplies, then we look for Asia Pacific, where the greatest incremental growth in energy demand will come. China, Japan, Korea, it didn't work that way. They say they signed a deal with China, $400 billion, and they signed a similar deal when I was in the embassy back in 1989. And since then, they made progress. 99%, everything is okay, they say. Just 1% is about the price, which is very critical. And it's not going to fly, I can tell you. So Russia depends heavily on Europe, number one in gas, Germany, number two is Turkey. We are critical. So nuclear power station, defense missiles, and also I will expect more and more Russian companies to invest in Turkey's downstream, in power generation especially, gas-fired power plants. They will come and collect them when there is distress asset and consolidation in the market. So the next 5-6 years, I don't think that we will have much peace in the region. The frozen conflict in South Caucasus might anytime, as Mustafa said, blow up. What will happen in the Black Sea? NATO, naval step up. Syria will be with us like Lebanon for the next 5-10 years. I don't think we are going to have any meaningful peace there. Let's not be illusionary. And Russia will continue to be a strategic rival to the West, not a partner as EU and US thought. Also, we have a huge leadership gap, both in the US and in Europe. Until the presidential election is over, then new president, hopefully Hillary, moves to White House. Don't expect any serious decision there. In Europe, Brexit, another 3 years. Then rising tide of neo-Nazis, as well as the immigration problem, loss of competitiveness. Whereas in the East, we have strong leadership. Xi Jinping in China, in India, and Putin in Russia. So also power shift that we have been talking about for the past 20 years. Yes, power is shifting towards East. Turkey, being situated just in the heart of it, I think has a critical role. If Turkey plays it wisely, balances its relationship without being hostage to any power and using energy as an important leverage, because in today's world the buyers are the king, not the sellers. And the geopolitics and energy, I think we have to approach them in a very, very different way in today's world, because the game has changed. the players of the game has changed, and the rules of the game have changed. Let me stop here before testing your patience. Thank you. Thank you.
Well, I mean, we sort of also heard a bit, a bridge to the second session, where it'll be more about the energy. But I think one of the points you made about China is relevant, and I'm always reminded of a story. I don't know if it's true or not, but this was transmitted to me by one of ECA's predecessors in the foreign ministry. So when Shevardnadze was the last foreign minister of the Soviet Union, he paid a visit to Shanghai to visit Deng Xiaoping about some border dispute at the little island of the river. And as he's waiting for Deng Xiaoping to come, he goes into this big room and there's a huge map of Eurasia where, I'll get the colors mixed up, but it doesn't matter. Half of the Soviet Union was in red, the other one was in yellow, and half, and all of China was in yellow. So after Deng Xiaoping tells Shevardnadze, don't worry, I know why you're here, you can have the island, don't worry about it. Shevardnadze goes, why is half my country in yellow? And Deng Xiaoping goes, because one day, half your country will be Chinese. It will not happen while we are alive, it will not happen when our children will be alive, it might not even happen when our grandchildren will be alive. But someday, this is what's going to happen. Anyway, it's another perspective on the East and China. Sanford, the floor is yours.
I guess it's on. Thank you very much. I listened with great interest to the China element, but I think the focus of where we are in this region is extremely important to what happens also for China. My focus is to go back on in the history and look a little bit of what's been accomplished over the period of time up until we can project for the next 25 years. The relationships in this region have been between Russia and Turkey, and certainly other countries have been involved. But predicting what's going to happen is, as they say, in the land of the blind man, the one-eyed man is king. And up here on our panel, we've got a lot of people with one eyes who are trying to predict, but it's very difficult to make these forecasts, let alone tomorrow or the next day or the next week. The interesting thing about the past is how Turkey and Russia have had relationships and how they've both grown. The per capita income, for example, in Russia has grown to $24,000 and Turkey has grown to $19,000. So you're seeing them grow from in 1990, they were 8,000 in Russia, and it was 4,000 in Turkey. So you've seen massive, you know, achievements in terms of the growth of the economies in these areas. So while these modernizations have taken place, there are other countries that have been affected by this whole Soviet Union and the post-Soviet Union period. Russia, of course, provided the first loans to Turkey when they became an independent country. So they've had relations going back that far. The loans that they provided were very, very important to Turkey at the time, and I don't think that's been forgotten by Turkey. So this past history, I think, is a very important element to keep in mind. Also to keep in mind is that there hasn't been any world conflict, and world conflict, which took place in the 20th century with two major wars, really was devastating to that particular century, but it's not happened so far in the 21st century. And so the hope, at least in my view, the hope is that we create more trade and trade-related aspects. A mentor of mine, Samuel Pizar, in 1970, wrote a book called Coexistence in Commerce. And that was of how the Soviet Union could achieve better progress in terms of its growth and its stability and its own security by creating commerce with the West. Now, this was the Soviet view at that time, that it was never going to happen. There was the Cold War. Now you're looking at a time when this is changing. And you can see by the economic statistics, there's more to risk today for families and homes by encouraging trade rather than not encouraging trade. And the conflicts can be resolved by things like the energy policy that Mehmet alluded to, and particularly the signature of this contract between Turkey and Russia. Now, does that make all these problems go away? Probably not. I mean, I remember my first visit to Russia, as Dmitry pointed out, was in 1966. And everybody asked me, what was Russia and Moscow in particular like then? I mean, how about the the traffic jams on what was then known as Gorky Street? What were they like? And I said, well, I went there in the winter time, and there wasn't any real problems with traffic jams. And the simple reason was there weren't any cars. Now, if you go there, that you can take a car and go down Tereskaya, and you can get out and have a cup of coffee and get back into your taxi a block later. So it's an extraordinary situation which has changed in Russia and its development. In Turkey, when I came in the early 70s, there was a continual conflict politically between Demirel and Ecevit, because they really had not any focus of any kind of cooperation. And then the revolution, which I watched in Taksim Square, which was people being shot while I was sitting having my coffee at the then Sheraton Hotel. Now, these are major changes that have taken place in these countries over that period of time, just in my lifetime. And I'm reminded of this, and that's why I say going back to find out where we were before and where we're going today is a very important ingredient. Now, as far as Putin is concerned, I think that there's been a very good book that Fiona wrote, and I think that the understanding of Putin probably has different chapters, and I don't think the last chapter has yet to be written. The problems in the period 2000, when I was working in Moscow, was that Putin had stabilized things. He had done a lot of things very positive. He had created new entrepreneurs, very exciting opportunities for investment. But today, and in particularly last year alone, over $60 billion of private equity money left Russia. So in other words, new direct investment is very necessary for Russia, but they're pulling out. And not only that, but the venture capitalists and the other people in that marketplace, they're leaving. So this human resource is an extremely important aspect. Now, you take that with Russia, and you take that with Turkey, and also, as you well know, with the current situation in Turkey, is foreign direct investment is declining. It's not improving and not increasing. So these are very important elements for countries. And if you use a post-Soviet example like Poland, the Polish per capita income is about 24,000, and they were about the same level as Turkey 25 years ago. Their GDP has grown startlingly, and their direct investment has increased over that same period of time by 25 times. So these are also contrasts between what is the post-Soviet impact in terms of not only the countries that used to be part of the Soviet bloc, but also the impact that it's had on the region as a whole. But all in all, it's been a peaceful aspect of it. But we all looking at the Middle East, which of course has to flow through Turkey. I mean, everything is making it a very central aspect of why Turkey is so pivotal in this this aspect, both politically, in terms of security, in terms of NATO, and concerns the EU. These are really important. It's really an important area. And as far as the Black Sea Navy, which I thought was a very interesting one, I remember the Swiss have a very, very powerful navy. And of course, they're completely landlocked. And in a funny way, with the Bosphorus, Russia is as well. So there's how can that actually take place in terms of being a strong navy, except if the West, in terms of particularly the NATO, lets that disappear. But there are lots of questions, and as Mark Twain said, denial is not just a river in Egypt. And I think we live for a large degree in this whole area of denial. And when we get into next 25 years of forecasting, I think the one-eyed man again is probably going to be king. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. And we should really take note of some of the numbers, right? So 25 billion have left in the last year alone. Right? Plus the human resources that Russians leaving.
No, 50, the number is higher.
It's 56 billion. All right. Lastly, we are running a bit over, but I think it's been an interesting session, maybe sort of setting the scene for what is to follow. Our last speaker is Alexander Vasiliev. You've heard quite a bit about the post-Soviet space. You live in that space.
Yes, I lived a little bit. Besides, I have my very tragical personal history because my relatives lived in Uzbekistan, and in 1993 they had to leave for Russia. In Soviet Union they considered to be very prosperous people. They were miners in Uzbekistan, in the city of Angren. And I remember in I was a child then. In 1988, my uncle from Uzbekistan, from Angren, came to Moscow, and he had a bag full of Soviet rubles, full of money. It was miners in Soviet Union. There were very prestigious profession. In 1993, when Soviet Union collapsed, they had to move to Russia, and they left everything they had in Uzbekistan. They had flat, they had a cottage house, they had car. They left everything just for nothing, and left and moved to Russia. They didn't manage to settle to stay in Moscow. They stayed in a small city, in small town of Kaluga, south to Moscow. And I can say that at that period there was no strict policy of New Russia towards those Russians who stayed in these new Soviet republics, because these my relatives, they were Russians by origin, but they couldn't get Russian citizenship for 20 years. 20 years they stayed people without passports, without any documents, and they survived only because we had a lot of relatives in Central Russia, as my grandmother had 11 sisters and brothers, and all the relatives gathered together and helped them to survive, physically survive. Coming back to the topic of our discussion, I can see that speaking about post-Soviet space, excluding maybe Baltic states, we can say that these countries have much in common, but at the same time they have much differences, ethnic differences, religious differences, demographic differences, economic, political differences. But still, they have some common topics that can unite them, and I can say that we shall not underestimate common historical past, because many of rulers of elites in Central Asia, they are still they were promoted to their ranks and during Soviet period, during Soviet era, and this is one of the points that can unite and connect Russia to Central Asian, especially Central Asian states. And I think that we shall use this term post-Soviet space for a long time. In my book, I wrote about connections about policy of Ottoman Empire in Central Asia. There was an interesting episode. It was about fight between Shaybanids and Bukhara Safavids in Iran and Ottomans for the Timurid legacy. And you know, last Timurid fled to India in the middle of 16th century, and then for 100 years, these three huge empires, partly Ottoman Empire and mostly Safavid and Shaybanids, they fought for their lands being incorporated into Timurid Empire. Another example, I can say that all of you know the state of the Golden Horde, and we still use the term of post-Golden Horde states, including Muscovite Kingdom and Kazan, Crimea, Nogai Horde, and so on. So I think that this term will stay in history, and we'll use it for a period of time only as a historical term, showing us that transition period from post-Soviet era to new type of relations between Russia and these new republics of Central Asia. The second question was whether Putin wanted to restore the Soviet Union, or is that nostalgia? So I wanted to quote Putin here, because once he said that those who do not regret the fall of the Soviet Union doesn't have their heart. And those who want to rebuild the Soviet Union, they doesn't have their mind. I think that we often percept these post-Soviet countries as a sphere of fight between Russia and the West, Turkey and the West, China and Russia. But I think that we shall keep in mind that during these 25 years, these independent countries, they became self-sufficient, and they do not need Russia, Turkey, or United States to approve what they do in the sphere of internal politics or in their foreign policy. I would say that Putin's strategy was not to renew the Soviet influence and the Soviet system in these regions, but to build a new model of cooperation with these countries. And he wanted to make stress more on economical cooperation, and through economical cooperation preserve Russian influence in this region. And nowadays I see a lot of debates between so-called liberals in Russia, inside of Russia, and so-called patriotic forces inside of Russia, and they are still arguing, why do we need Central Asia and what our profits in Central Asia? What our gains in Central Asia and what our goals in Central Asia? And I think that this so-called economic cooperation union, Eurasian Cooperation Union, that was founded by Putin and Nazarbayev, it was such an attempt to shape new interests of new Russia in this region. And I think that has a lot of, this project of economic cooperation has a lot of challenges, because due to economic situation in Russia, during the last 2 years, Russian goods, they became much more cheaper than, for example, food and goods produced in Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan. And Russia started to gain much more economic influence in national economies of Central Asian countries. And this was a very great challenge to Kazakhstan. And last year we looked that on the highest level, Kazakhstan officials and Russian officials discussed this matter. Of course, there is some kind of nostalgia among Russian elite on old Soviet times. But being the representative of younger generation, I can say that young people, they rethink this Soviet past. Many of them were born in the last years of Soviet Union, and as people who was rather small at that period, they remember only good sides of Soviet system. They, you know, when you remember your childhood, you mostly remember positive sides. And from the other hand, we have a new generation of Russian people, of Russian youth, who was born in 1990s, and they are much more pragmatic according to Central Asia. And I think that once this generation change will say its word and will influence Russian policy in the region. Talking about the limits of Russian influence in the region, I can say that I can quote a very famous Tsarist general, General Grodekov, who stated out that a settlement of that each Russian settlement in Central Asia is worth a battalion of Russian troops in that region. And I think that this is the very important limit to Russian influence, because a lot of Russians left Central Asia, left Uzbekistan, left Kyrgyzstan, Turkmenistan, and this undermined basis for Russian influence and maybe some Russian gains in that region. The second one is economic weakness of Russian Federation. It's not as strong as Soviet Union was, and it's very difficult to choose how shall we help Central Asia, what programs shall we choose for Central Asian countries. And Russian economic cooperation is going on bilateral basis with these countries. And we all knew some huge water projects, water generation, water electricity generation plants in Central Asia that has been built, for example, in Tajikistan and in Kyrgyzstan, but they are proceeding their activity against interests of Uzbekistan, for example. And this is another point of another matter that limits Russian influence in the region. And of course, as I said, the change of the generations, both in Russia and in Central Asia, will start new period, I think, in the relations between these countries and Russia. I don't think that Soviet space is stable and vibrant. It's not exporter of security. We had a lot of frozen conflicts, and I think that in 1990s, when many of these conflicts broke out, Russia didn't want to start this active process of rebuilding national borders in Central Asia, in the Caucasus, and it's following the same policy right now, I think. And I can say that the security in Central Asia is not a question only of the internal security of these states. It's also the internal security issue of Russia, of Russian internal security, because we have a lot of migrants and large flow of labor force from Tajikistan, from Uzbekistan, from Kyrgyzstan to Russia, and these people, they made a significant contribution to national product of Tajikistan, of Uzbekistan, of Kyrgyzstan. And 2 years ago, when we faced Western restrictions, Western sanctions, most of these people, they lost their work because Russians, who ordered them some works, and they weren't able to pay them. And now they are coming back to Central Asia, and it's one of the factors of instability in the region. Another issue is that still we have some not border conflicts, but contested regions with Central Asian, Caucasian states, Ukraine, and for example, we had very difficult situation with Kyrgyzstan, although it doesn't have a common border with Russia, but they consider, for example, the region of Khakassia as their homeland, from where they came to the modern Kyrgyzia. And many of Kyrgyz people, they returned to Khakassia, and it was a great problem because they started conflicts with local Turkic population, saying that it's our land, it's our country, who are you? It's our land, it was our land, and it's our land now. But those who stayed, they are almost native population of this land. So, I think that in the next 25 years, we'll face this region as very dynamic. Unfortunately, it, to my opinion, won't be stable. And we see growing poverty and growing social-economical reasons, problems, and I think that Russia shall shape his policy better towards Central Asia, because until now we can't shape exactly, we can't figure out exactly what are our goals in Central Asia and what are, for example, our aims. So, thank you very much. I think it's...
Yeah, thank you, thank you. You tried very concisely to answer each one of the questions and given us more food for thought. We've run out of time. I mean, the idea was also to have an exchange with you, but I think we should just take a break. There's coffee outside for everybody. There's coffee outside for everybody. The next session is actually a smaller session, the three speakers, so that would allow us to have more time for discussion and maybe some